We've boiled down our max n prescription into two steps, right? The first thing is we want the probability distribution to satisfy this constraint on the average value of the waiting time. And the second thing is we want that particular probability distribution to have the maximum entropy, to maximize the function p log p, and I always forget the negative sign, so in fact we're maximizing the function negative sum over all states of the system p log p. And remember, states of the system here are how long you waited for a particular cap, okay, or rather how long you waited on a particular time you decided to start waiting. Okay. So this turns out to be a hard problem. Or at least it turns out to be a non-trivial problem. If you have a little calculus, you're really good at maximizing functions. Okay, so let's start there. Let's imagine in particular, and I'll use this very simple example of maximizing a function over a two-dimensional space. Okay. So you have, and let's call these the x1 and x2 axes. So I have some function, I'm just going to draw the contours for you, right? So here we go. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make it such that there's a single maximum over this space. And what we'll talk about in one of the appendices, if we have time, is why we can prove that the entropy function has a unique maximum, okay, even when you subject it to these constraints. Okay. We'll leave that. For now, you can just take it on faith that, in fact, this problem has a unique solution. Okay. So here's a function. I've given it a unique maximum, okay? And so if I want to, and we'll call this function f, okay? So using your amazing calculus skills, you know that the maximum of this function is defined as the point where the derivative of f with respect to x is 0. And remember, this is a vector here, so actually, of course, what this means is df dx1 is 0 and df dx2 is 0, okay? Now, yes, you might have accidentally hit a minimum, okay? So much for you, right? So just check to make sure it's not a minimum. Right, that's what you would do at least. Okay. So now the problem is that we're not allowed to range over this entire space. We're restricted to some subspace. We're restricted in particular to some constraint here. Okay. So how can we find the maximum of the function, not the global maximum, but the maximum that is also satisfying a set of constraints? And what I'll do is I'll draw those constraints as a line in this space. A point here, okay, is a valid argument for the function f, but it doesn't satisfy this constraint here. And what I'll do is define this constraint in the following way. I'll say the constraint is that g of x equals c, okay, where c is some number, right? And so just to be clear, for us, g of x, right, is, and in fact, it's better for us to write g of p, right? And we've set that equal to 4 minutes. Okay, so that's, just to remind you, our particular constraint. Okay, in fact, it's the function g, okay, is equal to 4. This is the general case here. Great. So what we want to do now is not find the maximum point, the top of the mountain. Okay, we want to find the point that is the maximum along this line. Okay, along this line defined by g of x equals c. So let me give you a little intuition about how you might do this, right? So imagine you're on like a train, right? You're on a train that's going through this mountainous landscape, right? And as you're going through down here, you'll see you're crossing contours of the function f, right? So you're going, in this case, you're going uphill, right? And so the function is increasing. So you know a point there, for example, is not a maximum of the function along this line, because if you wait a little bit longer, you'll get to this point here and you've already crossed another contour line. So here, you're going up, okay? Notice over here, okay, you're now going down the other side of the mountain. You're crossing contour lines in the other way. So you know, in fact, that the maximum can't be here because you were already higher over here. So somewhere between here and here is the maximum. You're going up, okay? And then later you're going down. The function's continuous. So somewhere in the middle, you've reached the peak, okay? And in particular, and depending on your visual imagination, you reach the peak when the contours of the function f are parallel to the track that you're taking. Okay? Where there's a tangent point between the contour and the direction of your motion on this sort of fictitious train that's traveling over the constraint. So, we know how to get the directions of the contours of the function f. Those are indeed just the gradient of the function. This is a vector, remember, right? And what we're going to say is that these are equal to the perpendiculars to the train tracks. So if the perpendicular to the contour is parallel to the perpendicular to the train track, okay, that means that the direction of the contour is parallel to the direction of the train track, right? If the two perpendiculars are parallel, so are the two original vectors. Okay. So then the next question is how can I get the perpendicular to the train track, right? And what I want you to do is imagine, okay, this is the train track for g of x equals c, and here's the train track for g of x equals c prime, and so forth. Okay? So here's another set of contours defined by the function g. And we want those two, we want the perpendiculars to these contours to be parallel to the perpendicular, to be parallel to the contours for f, or to be parallel to the perpendiculars to the contours for f. Okay? So what that means is that this gradient here, right, these arrows here, and in particular these arrows right here, are equal to some real number lambda times the gradient of the constraint. When this equation is satisfied, okay, when this equation here is satisfied, that means that these contours here are precisely parallel to these contours here. So in order to maximize a function f subject to constraints, don't solve this here, right? Don't solve this problem, solve this problem. And now you notice you have this mysterious value lambda. This is called the Lagrange multiplier. So what we're going to do is try to find a solution, okay, where the gradients are parallel to each other. In other words, that one can be transformed into another by scaling it by some constant factor along all axes. Okay. So this is the original sort of intuitive motivation for how to solve the problem of maximization subject to constraints when you have only a single constraint. Okay. What we do is we find the point at which these two gradients align. Okay. There's a wrinkle. Okay. The wrinkle is the following. It looks like we have only one constraint here. It looks like we have a single constraint, and our constraint is just that this function is equal to 4. Okay. But we actually have two constraints. Okay? Our second constraint is an overall normalization. And it says that we want this function p here to normalize to 1. If you sum all the probabilities of the different arrival times up, they have to equal 1. Now, of course, p is a probability, so we know that has to be true. And we didn't talk about it explicitly, but when we start wandering over function space, when these x's here become p's, right, we start manipulating the probabilities, what we want to do is be able to relax the constraint that they sum to 1 when we consider maximizing this function f. We want to be able to range over the entire space, including, for example, points where all the probabilities, all the p's are 0. And then later what we'll do is we'll impose the normalization constraint. Okay? So we actually have two constraints and not just one.